Good evening, everyone. Oh, praise the Lord. Welcome to Revive Indiana.
Woo!
How are you? God has been doing wonderful things in our area, as all of you probably already know. Through Kyle Martin and the Time to Revive team, God has turned our community upside down. Yeah. The Spirit of God is still moving among us, and we just can't keep our mouths closed. How many found your mouth? Well, we need to hear some voices tonight, okay? These are some things that I learned during the previous week when the team was here. Number one, the man on the street is open to receiving prayer.
Yes. Amen.
And there's a spiritual hunger among the lost. There really is. Many of you found that sharing your faith was not as hard as you first thought it was going to be. Let me see any hands. Hallelujah. Good. Number three, Christian young men and women are more eager to talk about Jesus than perhaps previous generations.
Amen.
Our young people have a hunger for God. Amen. They need us to challenge them, don't they? They need us to take the lead and say, follow me, here's the way to do it. Number four, God still performs miracles.
Amen.
And one of those miracles is he turns the hearts of the men in charge of a local corporation to open their doors to the teens here. And you'll hear more information in just a few minutes. Number five, God is well pleased when we love the lost, listen to their hearts, discern their needs, and respond in prayer and gospel. Number six, many Christians have been revived in heart to follow Jesus.
Amen.
I want to share this with you. It's a creed of Time to Revive. By the way, they're meeting down in Bloomington right now, too. They're going to have a meeting later on, I think, tonight, a corporate meeting, but they met at 5 o'clock, and they divided up into teams and went out into the Bloomington area to pray over certain areas, like a campus and places like that. So they're still together down there, and so there's just one big meeting going on from Goshen to Kokomo to Bloomington, and who knows where next. Well, I know where next, but I don't know if I'm supposed to say or not. This is the real confession of a Rwandan man the night before he was martyred. And for me to read it carefully, I put on my glasses. But I want you to listen to this. I'm part of the fellowship of the unashamed. The die has been cast. I have stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
I won't look back, let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed. My present makes sense, and my future is secure. I'm finished and done low living, sight walking, smooth knees, colorless dreams, tamed vision, worldly talking, cheap giving, and dwarfed goals. My face is set, my gait is fast, My goal is heaven. My road is narrow. My way is rough. My companions are few. My guide is reliable. My mission is clear. I won't give up, shut up, let up until I have stayed up, stored up, prayed up for the cause of Christ. I must go till he comes, give till I drop, preach till everyone knows, work till he stops me, and when he comes for his own, he will have no trouble recognizing me, because my banner will have been clear.
Praise the Lord.
If you are living that life, or you desire to live that kind of life, and with all your heart you intend to pursue that kind of life, I would invite you to stand with me now. Friends, there are 72,000 people in our county. And they say that at least 60,000 of them are unchurched and probably unsaved. There are more than 13,000 teenagers under the age of 18 who are unchurched. We have a mission. And the field is right around us, isn't it? And by us standing together, we're declaring that Jesus Christ is Lord over Howard County.
Amen.
And all the surrounding counties. And that there is how many churches?
One.
When you see me out on the street, all you need to do is say,
Amen.
Don't even say a word. One church.
Amen.
One church. One of the brothers that was with our pastor's prayer group from the very beginning, moved away. He had a dream. He sent it to me. It's Jim Klein. And he said, Logan, I saw it in a dream. Believers all over the area, passing one another and just going,
Amen.
One church. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Father, I ask today, oh God, for the anointing of your Holy Spirit to come and sweep through this place right now. God, even though we've had a wonderful time, we still need you. Oh, we are desperate for your presence. We are desperate for our county and our city.
Amen.
And for the brothers and sisters in other counties who have joined us. Oh, God, how we need you. We rejoice in you, but we need you. Lord, help us as we progress towards taking the gospel to the streets of this city and of this county, encountering those who need Jesus. Oh, Lord, let this Rwandan man's benediction weigh upon our hearts, that we would be extremely serious about being a Christian. It's not just a fun thing to do. It's not just the thing in this community to be. But rather, it is a very serious lifelong commitment, because we have been transformed by the power of God. And the Holy Ghost has come to dwell within us. And we are filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. And we love the lost. And we will listen to them. And we will discern. And we will respond with the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And minister to us tonight. Set us free from whatever bondages we might be bound by. May you be glorified. May we be edified, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Let's sing together as one voice, as one body, as one church, as Logan said. Jesus, our
More more than we have in the past 3 years.
Amen.
We had to go out and pray for people to allow and get out of our comfort zone, and it just made everybody grow so much. We had one teen in our group, and he had his paper in his pocket of an address he was supposed to go to. And so he was looking for it, and he turned his pocket inside out and could not find it anywhere. They were driving around trying to find the address, and they found two men digging in a dumpster. They were able to stop and help those two men, and be able to introduce them to God.
Amen.
Afterwards, he reached into his pocket and there was a piece of paper.
A week ago today, we were holding our services, and we just allowed the people to come up and testify about what the Lord had done in their lives. And normally, 11:30, 12 o'clock, we're out the door. We went till 1.
Amen.
At the end, I was about to give the blessing. And a next door neighbor was next door to the church, Andy Lander, a guy that we've been praying for 7 years since he moved into the neighborhood. Coming through the front door of the church, through all the people, up to the front, I need an altar.
Thanks for sharing, Terry. That's awesome. Okay, one or two others. We have somebody else out here with a story to tell. A song in your heart. You're playing, but... All right, come on up.
I heard a story just this morning, and one of the ladies said she went out on the team already, and the teams have still been going out. Praise the Lord that the revival is probably just now beginning.
Amen.
Because our community is seeing the need, and we're going out in the wonderful. We had a little training.
Yes.
If we want revival, we can then start right now here in our own community. Praise the Lord. Anyway, they happen to have a fifth team member go with them this week. That normally doesn't happen. But anyway, this fifth team member was so tempted to go, so she drove. And as it turned out, they went around to the parks and were praying for people. And the team member herself on the very next day was taking a journey and a little trip. And she happened along a hitchhiker. Well, normally she would have never stopped to talk to a hitchhiker or pick one up. Or at least she thought she was a hitchhiker. And as it turned out, which she got brave enough to stop, and this lady happened to be doing those over the country tours on foot, and she happened to be a lady pastor. So I don't know who ministered to who, but isn't that a wonderful story? I happened to have all the Amish men in my home that called for the revival to come to Elkhart, Indiana. And that particular man said, you know, had I just gone down the road and talked to another man, that revival probably would have never happened. He said, it just happened to me, though, that I walked into that Ace Hardware store that day where little Kyle Martin had grown up all of his life, his mother told me, in the store. And he asked about Kyle. He said, I didn't even know he was really preaching or much. And the mom told what he was doing. He said, oh, it'd be so wonderful if he could bring revival to our Amish community. And he said, just if I'd gone the other way, no one would have been able to have Kokomo, God loves us.
And I'd like to thank God for inviting me and the team that came to Kokomo. On the last Monday, I went out with the team, and me and the three other individuals that were together, we didn't know each other, but we got a chance to meet one another. And
on last Saturday, one of the young ladies that I went out with, she was out again with one of the other teams, and she ran into a young man, and they were listening to him, and asked him what his name, and he said, my name was Jack Woodard. And she said, it is. And I went, God, what's the name, John? He said, that's my dad. I'm his son, and he said, I really need Jesus. And they had an opportunity to witness to him and pray for him. And the next day or two, he checked himself into drug rehab. He's in the corner right now in drug rehab.
Go.
We have time for one more. I see one more. Okay.
He was part of the team that witnessed the Jackson.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Come on, sir.
I kind of want to challenge the churches since this is Revive Indiana. We have strip clubs in this town, and I'm sure this is the men's prayer breakfast. Dan DeMala is one of the owners, and Don Draper is the other. One of those men is close to salvation, but he doesn't believe that he can be saved because of what he's done. So let's pray, one, that God will send workers across his path. And I've heard from different people that the hip hugger is known worldwide. So why can't our God save that man and turn these places into house of worship?
Well, we've been learning to trust in divine appointments, trusting that God is going to meet us before we even get there. And Logan, like you said, the people on the street are ready. So let's keep collecting those stories because we're active out there doing the work that Jesus invited us to do. Now I'm going to invite Terry Lindsay to come up here. He's got to an announcement to make from Chrysler.
Good evening, everyone. I'm not sure who all was at the Revive last week when we announced from the platform that we had gotten into Christ, or they were told when they came in to raise your hand if you were there for the announcement. If not, and I know there's some folks here that haven't heard this story, and I'll be as brief as possible, but they were told, Kyle and the team were told when they came in to Kokomo, when they targeted Chrysler, that there would be no way that they would ever get into Chrysler. And through God's miraculous work in me, I thank you for that. I hope that everyone this past week has learned how to follow the Holy Spirit when he speaks to you. Because when he speaks to you, you'll know it. He doesn't tell you to do things that are off collar or off wall. When he speaks to you, you know that he speaks to you. And when you walk out and you step out and you do the things that he tells you to do, the next time he speaks to you, you'll know that it's him. He's been doing that to me ever since. Tonight is wonderful for me. I needed this tonight. I've been drained. I've been spiritually attacked all week long since the Revive team has left. Because we have work left to do, folks. We got into one plan, my plan, the casting plan. And that casting plan became something besides a die-cast plan. We were casting out the enemy. There's molds in that plant that make parts, and there's mold makers, but the mold maker came into that plant. He broke the doors wide open and allowed the Word of God to be shared in there. I want to thank the Lord for that today, because to be here, we all enjoyed the presence of the Holy Spirit during that song. I know we did, and that feels good in here. But when you see the Spirit of the Lord break bondage, when you see Him break sinners down, when you see Him break through, and the excitement, the electricity in that plant was, there's people here today that will testify to it. It was, wow. When He came through that unsuspecting characters had nothing to say. He shut the mouths of a lot of folks, and everyone that come in contact, everyone in that plant just had something great to say with what happened in there. I just want to praise God for what he's done in the casting, and what he's lifted up. But our work's not done this week, as I was planning to go into the other plants, because Chrysler's not done. We have one plant, we have four plants left to go into. If you're here tonight and you work in one of those plants, start walking those plants. Start praying over those plants. Start taking back territory that the enemy has stolen from us over the years. Take it back. As we take steps through those plants, we can regain that territory. Prepare the way, because this coming week, this Tuesday and Thursday, we plan to be in three of those plants. We still don't have final approval to go in. There's been a little roadblock, but that roadblock will be removed. Amen. Just like the roadblock was removed last week. There's two names I want you to lift up to prayer tonight and until Tuesday morning. Jason and Mike. Pray for those folks. Pray for those two men that have a decision to make, and God will show them the right decision to make. I know we're going to need over 900 people, volunteers, to go into these plants and bless people in these plants. As I walked into the plants this week, God went before me. He opened doors that weren't open until I got there. And I just thank him for that. So this coming week, as we prepare to go into the other plants, even the following week, we'll go into the transmission plant. God willing, and I know he'll open those doors, because I'm just about naive enough now to know that he will do what he says, what he promises he'll do. He's put that in my spirit. So just pray with me this week that Christ will be completely opened up. All five plants. 685, 1166, 1302, hourly, salary. Each and every person will have a chance. 22 people gave their lives to Christ in the casting. See when we're obedient to his call, what he does. So if you're here tonight and he's calling you to do something in your community, in your work, step out. Because he'll meet you. He don't give you bad ideas. He don't give you ideas that will get you in any trouble at all. He just gives you ideas that will get his kingdom advanced into this country, into this state, into this town is what we need. So I want to bring Deb up. She's going to have a little announcement about signing up for what we're about to do in the next week and a half. Rest of Christ.
Thanks, Terry. I just want to thank Terry, you know, for his obedience to the Lord. Because, you know, when we step out sometimes, we put our whole future and our family's future on the line. And thank you, Terry, and his wife for that. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about volunteers, but you know, in Luke it says the harvest is great, and you know, God, I don't think we knew a month ago the harvest was great in our city. I mean, I think a lot of you would agree with me. We had no idea. God has changed us and opened our eyes so much, but it says the labors are few. So tonight I'm asking you, we have such a monumental task in front of us. We need about 600 volunteers to accomplish this in the Chrysler plants. So I've got sign-up sheets that look like this. We're going to divide it down per shifts, and we're going to do about 4-hour shifts this time instead of hour shifts, so hopefully we can go with less volunteers. If you went into Chrysler Place last time, we need you. If you work at Chrysler, we need you, because we need some tour guides, is that what they call it? Tour guides, to take the people through. And, you know, I didn't get to go to Chrysler this time because I was busy on the backside doing some of the work. But I'm going to go this time, and I know, I can tell you what I'm thinking. I'm just going to be transparent with you today. It scares me to death, because this is going to be a different situation than it was at the other Chrysler plant. They don't have a cafeteria. Last time, they just opened up the cafeteria, if people were in prayer, they got to come into it. This time, we're going to go out to the plant where they are, so if there's a break or whatever, we'll just be able to walk up in and talk to the people. But you know what? After last week, I'm going to take that challenge. You know, I'm going to overcome, and I'm going to go do it. I'm going to go in, use the factories, and I hope a lot of you will too. Last night, time to revive, bought us down 5,000 Bibles from Goshen.
Amen.
And Kyle said to give them to as many of the employees that we could, but we also want to open that up to give to the family. So you talk to some of the employees, they said they got 3 or 4 kids at home, or their grandmother, somebody wants a Bible. We've got them all packed today. We've got 3,000 packed today. So if you go to your question, you're going to have that packed with 15 Bibles and 15 armbands in there. So we are also looking for 3 vans because we need to facilitate these Bibles getting to the factories. So on Tuesday, we need 1 van and 2 drivers. On Thursday, we need 2 vans because we're doing 2 different plants, and we need 4 drivers. So we have them ready to go Tuesday, but Thursday we're going to have to repack in the whole shift. So when one shift comes out and runs those backpacks out, we're going to have to pack and get it back in there. So if you think that's something you might do, and that's going to take a whole day, so it'd be like from 7 in the morning till probably 5 or 6 in the evening. And so I'm going to have these sign-up sheets outside out here. And also to let you guys know, you know, we in leadership are really scrambling to try to get this whole thing organized so we can keep this thing going. But in the meantime, I have heard so many teams going out. You know, people like Carol Street over here got only 3 people to the Lord this week.
Oh, Lord, my God.
seated.
Within this coming week, we will have a particular schedule for time to revive and revive Indiana in regards to prayer times weekly and a time once a month on a Saturday that will go out as a corporate group, just like we have done in the past. It encourages you, local churches, to develop your own teams and connect with another local church and go out together.
Amen.
It isn't about one particular group.
Right.
It's about the church.
Right.
The church. We do know this. Thursday morning, this coming Thursday morning, 7 o'clock, at Christian Heritage Church, we'll have a prayer time. Come on. No breakfast.
Years.
Amen.
For revival.
Amen.
But I want to share my heart completely with you tonight because I think it's necessary that I do. And I want to just set the stage for a moment about what's been going on. As men and women have been praying, and I know that it's been mentioned that there's many streams in the body of Christ, and all of us have our fellowships and our denominations and things like that, but God has supernaturally brought us together as one church.
Amen.
And I'm praising God for that tonight.
Amen.
But we that have gathered and have been gathering, whether it's a pastor's prayer group or huddle and so many others that I'm not even aware of, I sense in my spirit that we have prayed on the basis of Scripture and the power of the cross, asking that God would secure the boundaries of our city and our county. I believe that we have sought the face of God and He has heard us.
Amen.
And I believe that as I have traveled around the county and surrounding areas and in our city, and personally in my private prayer time and devotional time, I have driven some stakes into the ground. And as we have done that individually and corporately, we have prayed three things that I have become aware of. And we have repented, we have requested, and we have resisted. And I would like to show you from Scripture why I sense that and feel that it's necessary that I rehearse this in your hearing tonight. In the book of Daniel, chapter 9, we repent because we ask the Lord Jesus to forgive us of our sins that have taken place in our state, our city, our community, our county. We've asked God to forgive us as leaders, and especially those that pastor in this county. We have said, Lord, forgive us of our sins. As a pastor, I've had to say, Lord, forgive me for not having the heart of Christ. So many times we get caught up in doing what is expected of us to do, performing to the expectations of our peers. But that has led us into a spiritual stagnation. It has taken us into a place of dryness.
Come on, Pastor. Preach it.
But God is calling us to cry out for rain.
Yeah.
He's saying, oh God, and we can pray, God, send your rain. Send your refreshing power into our midst. And it doesn't matter what our title is as a Christian, a fellowship, or a denomination. But the fact is that we as men and women of God need a refreshing like we've never needed before. And it's only God that can meet our needs.
Yeah.
If I was in my home church, I might say that might make a Baptist or Methodist shout.
Thank you.
spirits have been given notice and evicted from the property of the power of the name of Jesus. There is no other name but the name of Jesus. Lord, Savior of all. Thank God. Men and women have stood their gap and rebuilt a hedge of protection around our city. And because of this, we have become a strategic church.
Amen.
We've claimed Isaiah 58, verse 11 and 12. The Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your soul with drought and strengthen your bones. You shall be like a watered garden and like a spring of water whose waters do not fail. Those from among you shall build the old waste places. You shall raise up the foundation of many generations, and you shall be called the repair of the breach, the restorer of streets to dwell in. It starts with us.
That's right. Come on, preach it.
We, the church, have entered into revival, and because we entered into revival, we have become strategic in our community.
Amen.
God sent the evangelist into our midst a few days ago.
Amen.
And reminded us of how we are to equip ourselves. And there was tremendous response. And the response is causing people to come to Christ every day. How many of us as leaders, how many of we as members of our local fellowships have went for weeks, days, and months without a glory?
Amen.
Without a report,
right,
of somebody coming to Christ. This is why there's excitement in this room.
That's right. Amen. Yes.
Babies are being born.
Yes.
And because babies are being born, diapers are going to have to be changed.
Come on, Pastor. That's real.
Discipleship must take place.
That's right. Come on, Pastor. That's right.
This is the first time in 47 years of ministry that I have seen and experienced so many people getting excited about discipleship.
Yes, yes.
This is real.
Yeah.
This is the reality of revival. Becoming strategic. We pray for our city to be reclaimed, restored, revived, and set on the path of righteousness. We've prayed that our borders would be secured and that God would give us grace and protect us and allow His angels to encamp about us. This has been done in humility and faith. And what our leadership has been doing of our local congregation. This requires feeding and discipling, counseling, community, building up and encouragement for looking outside to the city with a go-to, find and meet the need attitude. And it's an attitude we should have. We've been called to serve our city. You have been called to serve your city. The early church father, Jerome, advised his people to avoid the city life and cities altogether. Another early church theologian taught that Christ was against the city and that Christians should escape the pollution and idolatrous way of city life. As I was studying, I believe that we are salt and light.
Amen.
And that we're called to our city.
Amen.
That we're called to our community. That we're not called away from the city, but to the city.
Amen.
Our desire should be to bring peace to the city, as we're commanded in Jeremiah 29:7, and seek the peace of the city where I've caused you to be carried away captive, and to pray to the Lord for it, for in its peace you will have peace. When our city experiences a greater peace,
amen,
we will have greater peace.
Amen. Amen. That's right.
Amen.
Many of us have prayed for Baltimore in recent days. We've prayed for other cities in recent days. It is our responsibility to do so, but it is also our responsibility to pray that we maintain peace in this place.
Amen.
The church, you are the key.
That's right.
Loving one another and understanding that this city is a strategic mission. And since we have this mission and this call, and we are a strategic church, and because of that we are a missional church, which means that we need to get out of our sanctuaries and our meeting places.
That's right. Come on.
In to our city.
That's right. Amen. Preach it, Pastor.
As we've been doing.
Preach it, Pastor.
But it is evident here tonight that we have just began.
Yes, sir. Yes.
It is evident here there is an excitement about our city and its salvation. Thank God for the leadership in this city. Thank God for the leadership of the church in our city. When I was thinking about this, because of sin, cities today are human-centered and often violent and filled with friction, greed, and carnality. Sin runs freely through the streets and markets. It sits enthroned in the high places of civic life. Cities are characterized by many broken covenants, most of all the broken covenant with God. And in this humanistic context, the church is called to bring hope, healing, and restoration of God in the city.
Right, amen, amen.
And could I be bold enough to say to you tonight, it has begun to happen. This is just the beginning. I want to challenge you tonight with a vision to reach more, to do more, to yield. I don't think that we'll have any problem with strategy, because I believe we already have a biblical strategy to reach our city and our community. Here is where I think we're going to have to push the jello.
Amen. Amen.
Developing a place where God's presence dwells and his word. ways or not.
Amen.
Are we willing to say yes to God in such a fashion that wherever we walk, whatever we do, that's in our professional life, our business life, on the job, we're willing to put forth the effort to dwell, to walk, to live in His presence. It can only be done by purposely doing it.
Amen. That's good.
It just don't happen.
Amen.
It takes effort.
Yes. Amen.
It takes a lot of transparency. Some days we're doing the work of the Lord, we're living out our lives. And something happens and it seems like just like that. And He, the Holy Spirit, checks us. And I've had to say, God, I thought that was dead. I'm gone in me. Take a deep breath. I experience that His grace is sufficient. That His mercy endures forever. You think we guys with the suit and jacket and the tie have got it all together? Sometimes we're more broken than any of you. I walked into this pulpit tonight in fear and trembling. This is not another speaking engagement.
Amen.
This Amen. Is not a time slot to be filled. Amen. This is not just another worship service or experience. Life and death hangs in the balance.
Amen.
As Logan said, 60,000 unchurched. My God, have mercy on us.
Amen.
That is an indictment against us.
Yes, it is.
I'm going to leave here this week. I'm going to go on my face before God and pray.
As possible, too long. We have been the church, but not strategic. We've attempted to go our own ways.
That's right.
And do our own thing. And we high-five each other as we passed in the street or the coffee shop.
Right.
But since the evangelist has come by and reminded us, when we made a fault, the community was in code blue. We have found heartbeats.
Praise the Lord.
This isn't your church. He said, I began to weep. He said, I lost it. He said, come on. He said, this isn't your church. He said, okay, God, what do you want me to do? He said, I want you to call all the board and the elders together. And he said, I want you to do it on Sunday morning. Sunday morning comes, he calls them all in, he brings them up before the church. The church didn't know what was going on. And he starts instructing the board members and the elders to go to the walls and the lobbies and tear down all the signs and the charts. Bring them back in. He brings them back in and he tears them up and lays them in front of the altar area. And he said, church, I just want to inform you this morning that this is not my church and it's not yours. Amen. Spirit of humility swept across the congregation. That morning, three families were added to the church. The offerings have been greater than they've ever been. The band has increased by two or three people. New people are coming in every service because they took their hands off. Instead of owning the church, they became the church. And since it's his, we remember what Jesus said, I will build my church. My people that I pastor that are here tonight know that this is a problem for me, but I'm just going to be honest with you tonight. I can't finish the message. I've got 8 pages of notes and I'm just on page 2. I think maybe with this wonderful praise and worship tonight, with the exhortations and the challenges for these that have stood before us tonight, that maybe tonight we've had enough. And I pray that the Holy Spirit works with us in such a way that we leave here.
Amen.
Challenged and charged.
Amen.
Committed to reach Kokomo, Howard County, and the surrounding areas.
Amen.
And that our hearts will be tender, constantly, and continually. I believe tonight that my responsibility is to challenge you to draw a bigger circle. You all have our little sphere and circle of influence. But I believe God wants us to be challenged tonight to enlarge our circle. Jesus is soon to return. And it's our responsibility as a church to understand we must reach our city. The miracle of feeding the 5,000 provides a great example of how supernatural vision results in a faith attitude that produces a strategy for reaching our community, our county, and our state. I want you to stand with me. Because
because we are building a bigger circle. We must develop a faith for those 60,000.
Amen.
We must develop a faith to reach that 60,000. We senior pastors in this room tonight don't have to worry about filling up the pews of our churches, our church buildings, our fellowship buildings. I think we need to have the mindset of building a bigger circle and gaining a greater faith for the 60,000 in this county that are still unchurched. Revive Indiana, with the participation of each of our fellowships, I close with this. We can, we have, and we will. With what God has imparted to us, with what God has challenged us with, hundreds and thousands are coming.
Amen.
They're coming from the east, west, south. I'll never be the same. This revival restored my heart for so many. My ministry started in 1969, being a co-pastor and a bus pastor for my father. It was my responsibility to knock on door after door after door, hundreds of thousands of doors over a period of years, inviting people to Christ. Then I become a senior pastor. And I got lost. I got lost in the machinery. I got lost in the mechanics.
That's right. That's right.
Thank God. This bald-headed preacher. Because we are loved, we have this awesome.
we believe in the power of your healing touch that is more today. We still believe in miracles.
Yes.
So God, we want to pray for Pastor Phil that you would reach down, reach into his body and touch his nerves, touch his brain, touch his body, Lord God, and I pray that you would bring him back to fullness of health. God, we're just already praying and giving you thanks for the hope that we have and that there is eternal healing. So Lord, together in faith as a body who knows that you love us, we want to love on Pastor Phil and his family. Father, may your will be done. Amen.
Myself, Kevin Smith, Deb Copeland, have been assigned to oversee the ongoingness of what God is doing here. We need a lot of help. The brother over here that spoke to us about Christ, he's a chaplain of Christ. I didn't know if you knew that. I met with Terry and probably 16 other chaplains or so the other day. And I'm telling you, these chaplains are on fire for God.
Great job, Lord.
We are going to need a lot of help, and I know that your heart is open right now. So this is an open invitation to all of you who have a desire to see our county and our city return to Christ. I want to recognize Dusty Brown. She isn't in here. She's with the children. So every corporate meeting that we have, there will be child care up to age 5. The 5th grade, I'm sorry, up to 5th grade. Oh, there she is, back there. Hold your hands up, Dusty, so we can see. We have not made full decisions about when we're going to have corporate meetings like this. Do you want them every day or every other day? Whatever God says, that's what we'll do. But we want you to know we're working on communications. I expected about 200 more here tonight, but I realized that a lot of folks still haven't heard. So we're working on forms of communication to get the word out. And so we're asking the Lord to give us that wisdom. Is there anything else we need to do tonight? Hallelujah. We're going to worship one more time. Then we're going to close.
Thank you. receive background checks, so they are in a safe place and they are in safe hands when we come together to worship. You know, this upcoming Thursday is an opportunity for us as the church, or we as the church, to be, as Logan has said, that one church, that one voice in our community. This Thursday is National Day of Prayer. We want to extend an invitation to you to join us as we pray for our community and for our nation. This year's theme is Lord, Hear Our Cry. And we'll be crying out to the Lord in prayer around the courthouse square on the east side this Thursday from 12 to 1. Gathering. We're believing this year to have at least an assembly of 1,000. I believe that's a small number. It's what I've seen over God do in the last couple of weeks. Maybe it'll be 2,000. Maybe it'll be 3,000.
Restoration and healing.
Amen. So tonight we prophetically speak salvation.